My name is Troy Andresen. I'm the pastor or campus minister for this student church called His House Christian Fellowship. And we also have two full-time women's ministry coordinators, Kim Turner, right here, and Heather, my wife, in the back by the computer. And this year we have a fourth full-time staff member, and that is Nathan Ewald. He was hired over the summer, and his sister's cheering for him. And he is wrapping up getting his support raise, so we will see a lot more of him when he's fully funded in that, and if you could pray for that, that would be awesome. So His House is a non-denominational, Bible-based student church to this campus community. In our... little feedback there. Our allegiance is to God and His Word, and not to any particular name on a building. So, whatever your church background is, even if that's none, we want to welcome you, and we will give you our best to teach God's Word as we learn together how to become better followers of Jesus. And to kick off the school year, we're going to start a teaching series called Follow. And let me pray for the message right now. God, we thank you that we're here tonight to start off the school year. God, we thank you that we're in a dry place as it's pouring rain outside. And we just invite your Holy Spirit, your presence here. God, just help us to be in tune with you. Pray your Spirit would speak your words through me. And just open up all our ears to hear your truth. God, just ask you to eliminate distractions so we can tune into what you have for us. And we give you this time. In Jesus' name, amen. So tonight we're going to launch our Follow series by taking some cues from some of the first followers of Jesus. But I want to start with the word follow itself. The word follow has evolved a lot, especially in the last 5 years or so. The last few months I've been trying to use my Twitter account more. And the beginning of the summer, I posted this tweet about a curriculum we were doing for His House over the summer. It's called Follow Me by David Platt. It's a really, really good book, really good video curriculum. And so I tweeted about that, and the next day I saw I had a new follower on Twitter, and it was like my third tweet. So I was excited about that, and my new follower was Tom Rainer, and he's a Christian author. I've actually read some of his books. He wrote the book Simple Church and Surprising Insights from the Unchurched, and I just got a new book, I'm a Church Member. So that's kind of his passion. Church and being the church in modern culture. And so I'm thinking, wow, this is amazing. My first thoughts were, does he know about His House? Did he see some of my sermons online? Like, do we have some friends in common? Like, this is really cool. This famous person is following me. And then I put two and two together, and he's also the president and CEO of Lifeway, which is the company that publishes Follow Me. So when I hashtagged Follow Me on my tweet, he happened to catch that hashtag and click the follow button. And then when I looked a little closer at his profile, he was following about 93,000 other people as well. So it kind of took the specialness away from it for me. But back in the day, following someone actually meant you follow them. Like, follow the leader in playtime during childhood. If you used it figuratively, it still actually meant there was some level of interest involved in what that person said or did. There's still degrees and extremes of that, but there's at least some level of interest there. Unlike today, when following something can mean absolutely nothing. So, tonight we're going to pose the question, what kind of follower of Jesus will I choose to be? What kind of follower of Jesus will I choose to be? And there's two groups described in the Bible. And we'll start with the light and fluffy group. Group A is the crowd. The crowd are those seeking to enjoy Jesus. The crowd are those seeking to enjoy Jesus. Now, there's absolutely nothing wrong with enjoying Jesus. If we commit to follow him as king of our life, he puts us in a relationship with him. And the Bible describes us as his friend, his brother, his son, his bride. Those are all types of relationships on earth that we're supposed to enjoy. But the problem is when enjoyment is the highest aspiration of the relationship. We're going to look at a number of Bible passages tonight, so I encourage you to follow along. We have a few people that are going to help us out by reading those out loud with the microphone. I encourage you to follow along in either a paper Bible or electronic Bible. If you don't have your own Bible, there's some on the back table that you can keep, and don't feel bad about, if there's only a few back there, don't feel bad about taking one because we have boxes of them to give to people because that's where it's important. So we're going to look at Matthew 4, verse 23 through chapter 5, verse 2. So the end of Matthew 4, verse 23 through Matthew 5, 3.
Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching and listening to us, preaching the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness in the people. News about him spread all over Syria, and people brought to him all who were ill with various diseases, those suffering severe pain, the demon-possessed, those having seizures, and the paralyzed, and he healed them. Large crowds from Galilee, the Decapolis, Jerusalem, Judea, and the region across the Jordan followed him. Now when he saw the crowds, he went up on the mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven."
So, this went right into the Sermon on the Mount, which is a three-chapter sermon that Jesus preached to this large crowd that had started following him. And the large crowds were impressed with his teaching. It says that the end of the Sermon on the Mount, they were impressed. He spoke to someone with authority. And so Jesus is someone who can heal people, and he's a good communicator. Hey, let's follow Jesus. And that's not a bad start, but we'll see in this next passage, we start to get a little glimpse of the direction the crowd is going, and we see that it's a selfish relationship. So the next passage is Mark 3, verses 7 through 10. Mark 3, verses 7 through 10. There's some funny names in there, just do your best. Say them with confidence.
Jesus withdrew with his disciples to the lake, and a large crowd from Galilee followed. When they heard all he was doing, many people came to him from Judea, Jerusalem, Idumea, and the regions across the Jordan and around Tyre and Sidon. Because of the crowd, he told his disciples to have a small boat ready for him, to keep the people from crowding him. For he had healed many, so that those with diseases were pushing forward to touch him.
Can we turn that down just the main just a little bit? So here we see that the crowd here is not interested in the person of Jesus. They're just interested in what he can do for them. Word spread, hey, this guy heals. So this crowd almost turns into the mob. People are trying to get close to Jesus to touch him so they can be healed. And Jesus has this message he wants to tell this group of people, and he has to get off the shoreline and actually step into a boat to be able to talk to the people. And we're going to see that progression of the crowd go even a little further as Jesus reveals a little bit more of what he can do. This is, we're going to look quite a bit in John chapter 6, It's a really long chapter, but we're going to kind of take a few pieces out of it. So, John 6, verses 5 through 12. Jesus added to his repertoire, he can heal, he can speak, and he can generate food out of thin air. That's really cool. Let's follow Jesus. And so, just a little bit further in the same chapter, Jesus cuts to the heart of why these large crowds are following him. Let's look at verses 26 and 27.
Jesus answered, I tell you the truth, you are looking for me not because you saw miraculous signs, but because you ate for food that spoiled, but because you ate the loaves and had your fill. Do not work for food that spoils, but for food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. On him God the Father has placed his seal of approval.
So let's pause and make an observation here, and then we'll kind of wrap up that chapter and wrap up the context of the crowd. Earlier we saw that the crowds were following Jesus because these miracles he was performing. They're following Jesus because of what he was saying, and now because he was giving them food, free lunch. But Jesus said in that passage, you're not looking for me because of the signs. Because Jesus' picture of what the signs were for was different than what the crowd was thinking. The purpose of those miracles was not selfish enjoyment or entertainment, which is what they were after. The purpose of Jesus' miracles was not for selfish enjoyment, but to verify the truth of his message. I'll say it again. The purpose of Jesus' miracles was not for selfish enjoyment, but to verify the truth of his message. I'll go ahead and read just two quick verses about that. Mark 16:20 says, when the disciples went out and preached everywhere, and then the disciples went out and preached everywhere, and the Lord worked with them and confirmed his word by the signs that accompanied it. So Jesus confirmed the message by the miracles he was performing. Then Acts 2:22, Peter said, fellow Israelites, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did among you through him, as you yourselves know. So again, the miracles gave validity to the message about God's kingdom. The miracles were there to say, hey, there's supernatural power and authority at work here. So we should listen to this guy and apply the message he's saying. But the crowd didn't really care about the message. Other than that Jesus was an engaging speaker, they liked listening to him. You never know when he'll throw in a little performance and heal someone on the spot. By asking the crowd to apply what Jesus was saying to them to their lives personally and individually, well, that was another story. So, back to the context about why the crowds were following Jesus. Right after he cuts to the heart about their motives, he announces that he's the bread of life. And if you've got any kind of church background, you've probably heard that phrase And he begins to lay the foundation for communion. And in communion, we take a piece of bread that represents Jesus' body, a little cup of juice or wine that represents Jesus' blood. And we take that, and it reminds us that Jesus was the sacrificial lamb. He made a sacrifice for us to give us life. And if you're brand new to church, don't worry about not understanding that. Come talk with one of the staff and we'll fill you in on that. But this crowd didn't get what Jesus was talking about. They were thinking, he said, I'm the bread of life, need to eat my flesh. They were thinking he's talking about cannibalism instead of metaphor. And so we're going to conclude this chapter, verse 60 and 66 through 69.
On hearing it, many of his disciples said, this is a hard teaching. Who can accept it? From this time, many of his disciples turned back and no longer followed him. You do not want to leave too, do you? Jesus asked the 12. Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We believe and know that you are the Holy One of God.
So here we start to turn a corner. It doesn't take too much of an imagination to apply the concept of the crowd to life today. A lot of people say they follow Jesus or say they're a member of such and such a church. But for a lot of people, it's just a selfish follow. They just want to be entertained and fed. The worship music pumps them up it makes you feel all warm and cozy. They hear a message and they make some nice friends. And for some people, that's as deep as their faith ever goes. When the message starts to get a little challenging or personal or out of their comfort zone, the crowd looks to be entertaining somewhere else. But with that passage we just read, we also get a glimpse of the other group of followers of Jesus. And so we're going to talk about that group now. So the second group is the committed. The committed are those seeking to emulate Jesus. When the crowd left, Peter said to Jesus, where would we go? You have the words of life. So the committed realize there's life in following Jesus with all its ups and downs and not just comfortable zombie life. I'll say that again. The committed realize there's life, real life, in following Jesus with all its ups and downs, not just comfortable zombie life. Life without truly following Jesus is kind of like a living death. So it's kind of like a zombie. Yes, you can find momentary pleasures in this or that, or follow after a bunch of different pursuits, but it's not real life. But committing to Jesus brings full life, abundant life, deep, unexplainable joy, deep purpose to our lives. And then it also comes with persecution and spiritual warfare, but those build our character and help us rely on Jesus even more. So with the committed, it's not just about comfort and enjoyment. We're going to look at three short passages about when the core disciples started to follow Jesus. First is Matthew 4, verses 18 through 22.
As Jesus was walking beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon called Peter and his brother Andrew. They were casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. Come, follow me, Jesus said, and I will make you fishers of men. At once they left their nets and followed him. Going on from there, he saw two other brothers, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. They were in a boat with their father Zebedee, preparing their nets. Jesus called them, and immediately they left the boat and their father and followed him.
All right, and then Luke 5, 27 and 28. So that was Peter, Andrew, John, and James. And we're looking at Luke 5, verses 27 through 28.
Follow me, Jesus said to him. And Levi got up, left everything, and followed him.
So that's talking about Matthew, Levi. And then one more is John 1, verses 43 through 46.
The next day, Jesus decided to leave for Galilee. Finding Philip, he said to him, follow me. Philip, like Andrew and Peter, was from the town of Bethsaida. Philip found Nathanael and told him, we have found the one Moses wrote about in the law, and about whom the prophets also wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. Nazareth, can anything good come from there? Nathanael asked. Come and see, said Philip.
So let's just make three quick observations about what we just read. First, committing to Jesus involves leaving things behind. Committing to Jesus involves leaving things behind. Could be things that are wrong, could be things that waste our time, could be idols in our life, things that we put as more important than God in our lives. That's not comfortable, but when we do it, there's so much life and fulfillment in it. Second, committing to Jesus involves urgency. Committing to Jesus involves urgency. It's not something to wait till next semester or wait till the next season to figure out. The disciples followed Jesus immediately and completely. And then third observation is committing to Jesus involves applying his teaching. Committing to Jesus involves applying his teaching. Every one of these three passages started following Jesus immediately, which is awesome. It's cool to read about that and see that. But notice Philip's example in particular. That's the last passage we read. Jesus' primary ministry while he was on earth was to spread the good news about his kingdom. And he was a sucker for having compassion on people, so he healed people, all these places he went. But his main ministry while he was alive was to spread the good news about his kingdom. And so, as soon as Jesus told Philip, follow me, Philip went and found his friend Nathanael. So, Jesus, you want us to spread your word? Okay, let's start now. He didn't know anything, but he grabbed his friend and brought him along. He got started. So, God's intention when we commit to him isn't that we lock ourselves away in a library and we study the Bible until we really get a good understanding of it, and then we'll go out and apply it. That's not the way it's supposed to work. As soon as we start a relationship with Jesus, we can start applying something. And even if that's enthusiastically inviting others to join you in something, you're just taking the first step in yourself. And it can be that simple. Just like with Philip. And as we learn and grow, there's more that we can apply better. But the idea is that we start applying what we can as soon as we can. The idea is that we start applying what we can as soon as we can. And we're going to unpack this idea of being a committed follower of Jesus a lot more this semester. And just for future reference, if we ever talk about being a follower of Jesus here at this house, we're talking about the second group of being a committed follower. Let me share one more passage, and then we're going to wrap up with the story. The last passage is Luke 9, verses 57 through 62. Luke 9, verses 57 through 62.
As they were walking along the road, a man said to him, I will follow you wherever you go. Jesus replied, "Foxes have holes, and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head." He said to another man, "Follow me." But the man replied, "Lord, first let me go and bury my father." Jesus said to him, "Let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God." Still another said, "I will follow you, Lord, but first let me go back and say goodbye to my family." Jesus replied, "No one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God."
Thank you. So Jesus is looking for committed followers, not just groupies. Jesus is looking for committed followers, not just groupies. And if you're just checking it out for the first time, that is totally awesome and totally cool. But know that if you come into a relationship with Jesus, he expects it to be a complete relationship and not just a casual follower. So, applying this to today, whenever the Holy Spirit uses the Bible or a sermon or a Christian friend or any other circumstance to tell you there's something you need to work on, whether that means change this or go do that, this is where the crowd gets sifted out from the committed. Just committed, listen and try to obey. So let me wrap up with a true story. How many of you have heard about the guy who recently crossed the Grand Canyon on a tightrope? Most of you. Cool. We got a picture of him. His name's Nick Walenda. I'm not really sure how to pronounce that. It was broadcast live on the Discovery Channel. He crossed a quarter mile span across the river, which is like 1,500 feet down. And it took him 22 minutes to go that quarter mile. And he prayed to Jesus on microphone, on air the whole time, so that was pretty cool. A year before this, he crossed Niagara Falls on a tightrope, and I didn't even hear about that one. But he was the first to do that since the late 1800s. So, been over 100 years, nobody tried that, but before that, it had occurred a number of times in the 1800s. And the first one to cross Niagara Falls on a high wire was a French acrobat named Jean-François Gravelet, something like that. But he went by the stage name Charles Blondin, or the Great Blondin. And so there's a picture of him crossing the river at the bottom of Niagara Falls. Now, cameras have improved a lot since the mid-1800s.
That's pretty good.
His first crossing was on June 30th, 1859. Crossed 1,100-foot span in several later crossings after that. Blondin introduced variations. He crossed blindfolded, or on stilts, or in a gorilla costume, or pushing a wheelbarrow. Once he brought a little stove, once he brought a little stove halfway across and cooked himself an omelet. Niagara Falls on the tightrope. And surprisingly, he did not die by stunts. He died of diabetes in his 70s. But he was crazy. All these trips across were highly publicized and drew huge crowds of spectators. And a century later, in the 1950s, the Topps Bubblegum Company printed a sports card about Blondin, a trading card, like a baseball card. So one of his most talked about acts involved really engaging the crowd. He would take his wheelbarrow across and bring it back, and he'd get the crowd all worked up, and he'd holler to them, "Do you believe I can do that again?" And they would get all worked up, and so this cheering crowd would roar, "Yes, yes, we believe you can do that, Blondin." And then he would single out a guy nearby, and he would say, "You, sir, you believe I can do that again? And the man would, of course, confidently say, yes, yes, I believe you can. And Blondine would say, then sir, would you please get into the wheelbarrow? He also asked for volunteers to take across on his back. Strangely, no one ever took him up on those offers. Finally, he talked to his manager, whose name was Harry Colcord. He talked his manager into climbing on his back and went across with his manager on his back, just so he could actually bring someone across, because no one else was willing. You see, the great Blondine had many followers in the crowd, but few who committed their life into his hands. So what kind of follower of Jesus will you choose to be? Let me pray. God, we thank you for tonight, and we thank you for your word, and